It's my great privilege this evening to introduce our speaker, and I did find it a bit of a challenge to do so. I'll explain why in a minute. We do have every reason to be worried these days about U.S. policy in the Middle East. The terrible events in Paris have brought us to a fresh shock and anxiety about the radicalization of politics in the region and how it might spill over borders to our shores or any shores. Yet we know that, dismaying as they are, the deaths in Paris are a mere token of the deaths wrought on Syrian and Iraqi civilians, as well as Lebanese, Yemeni, and other civilians, similarly innocent, similarly killed as they went to work, schools, or markets. The numbers must awe us all. Over 250,000 deaths in Syria, of which some 30,000 were children. Over 500,000 dead in Iraq, and millions of refugees. No one in the US administration intended this, but something was fundamentally wrong with the policy they contrived, the vision they had of the region that led to this. Few are more prepared to analyze those choices and policies than Richard Falk, of whom more in a minute. Before introducing him, however, I would like to say a few words about this event and the people who helped bring him here, including the wonderful staff at the Paul Simon Public Policy Institute, with whom we share the privilege of organizing these lectures, as well as Cindy Byes of the SIU Law School and Olga Widener of the local United Nations chapter, and all those who pitched in to welcome Richard and his wife, Professor Hillel Elver, who is currently the UN Special Rapporteur on the Right to Food. Hillel Elver, can you raise your hand so people know where you are? You're a wonderful partner. But our particular gratitude is to the generosity of Jerry Milieu, Professor Emeritus of Political Science at the University of Massachusetts Amherst, who received his BA and PhD from the SIU Department of Political Science. I suppose I forgot to introduce myself, didn't I? I'm Virginia Tilley. I'm the chair of the Political Science Department. And I take pride in people having graduated from my department, even though I never met them. Professor Milieu endowed this lecture series to honor two of his mentors, Professors Ward Morton and David Kenney, for their more than 70 years of joint service to the department and university, and to express his personal appreciation for their mentoring roles in his undergraduate and graduate education at SIU. Since 1995, the Morton Kenney Lecture Series has brought some of the most influential politicians, policymakers, and scholars to SIU. Our bringing a scholar of Richard Falk's stature therefore expresses our appreciation and hopefully honors Professor Milieu's lasting gift to SIU's intellectual life. I find introducing Richard Falk a more difficult matter, however, for his work quite simply escapes summary. Going through his 54-page CV, which I'm told is incomplete, is like walking through a history of human rights, law, and related controversies over the past half century. His degrees in law from Yale Law School in 1955 and Harvard University in 1962, and even his long experience as Albert G. Milbank Professor of International Law and Practice at Princeton University, fade in proportion to the scale of this experience. Here we find his visiting professorships, including in Vietnam, Wales, Cairo, Bellagio, Malta, Stockholm, and elsewhere. His memberships on advisory boards, ranging from groups on global governance, demilitarization, nuclear weapons, and the Middle East, while sprinkled among them have been thoughtful extensions such as his service to the Buddhist Religious Society. His service advising centers and institutes, such as the Jerusalem Institute for the Study of Society, the Council to Monitor Human Rights in Iran, the Center on Violence and Human Survival, the Center for the Study of the Global South, the Institute on the Holocaust and Genocide, the International Association Against Nuclear Arms, the Tannenbaum Center for Interreligious Understanding, the American-Iranian Council, and the Al Karama Foundation on Human Rights in the Arab World. And his expert testimony, ranging from the Pentagon Papers case to the SALT II treaty hearings and principal cases involving the Algonquin Nation of Canada. We also find some 60 books, oh sorry, regarding that key marker of academic stature, journal articles. Well, I was overwhelmed by the list. I thought I'd simply share with you a numerical count of these, but starting with his first publication in 1959, I ran out of steam at 200 somewhere in the mid-1980s. His writings include flagship journals in international law, as well as important public intellectual forums such as The Nation. We also find some 60 books he has published as author or editor, exploring questions from the environment and climate change to nuclear disarmament, and international legal cases involving Southwest Africa, Cuba, Vietnam, and the Arab-Israeli conflict. And this leaves out his long history of research and analysis on environment and sustainability, including his 1971 classic volume, This Endangered Planet, and his more recent role as a founding executive committee member of the International Oceans Observatory. Among all these topics, he has consistently published analyses interrogating larger problems of the world's legal order and its governance. We are here to listen to his views on the Middle East, however, and here we find a prodigious body of experience. His volumes on the Middle East are so extensive that they inspired Jean Alain to assemble them in an edited volume, Unlocking the Middle East, The Writings of Richard Falk. His book titles related to this evening's topic include Religion and Human Global Governance, Legality and Legitimacy in Global Affairs, Costs of War, International Law, the UN, and World Order After Iraq, Human Rights, Critical Concepts in Political Science, Humanitarian Intervention and the Legitimacy Wars, Reimagining Humane Global Governance, and Chaos and Counter-Revolution After the Arab Spring. Professor Falk just completed a term as Special Rapporteur for the United Nations Human Rights Council on the occupied Palestinian territory, a job that no one takes without courting controversy. But rarely has he ever been challenged on his facts or his legal analysis, and his impartial, unflagging, and steady commitment to human rights and humanitarian values is legendary. It is therefore with keen interest on my own part to hear what he has to say at this critical juncture in U.S. foreign policy that I ask you to welcome Professor Richard Falk.
Thank you, Virginia, for that very elaborate introduction. It does a rather good job of making me seem like a lifelong dilettante, having touched on all these varied subjects. But I want to thank Virginia Tilley, particularly on behalf of my wife Hilal and myself, for her hospitality while we were here, and the sponsors for inviting me. It's, in some ways, it's a particular honor and challenge to speak at in a lecture series that was founded in order to honor an inspiring teacher. It sort of sets the bar rather high if one tries to live up to that kind of legacy. Speaking of U.S. failed policy in the Middle East needs at least a preliminary clarification to the degree of acknowledging that no government and no expert has charted a path that would avoid failure. In other words, in some ways, the situation that has evolved in the Middle East makes failure unavoidable. The question is, how deep is that failure, and how much do we learn from the mistakes that have been made in trying to respond to the challenges posed by these very tumultuous events that have occurred. And my effort this evening is really to try to understand what might have been a better way of dealing with some of the crucial challenges posed by what's happened in that region, and wondering both why those mistakes have been not only made but seemingly repeatedly made, and why there's such a poor learning curve in relation to the policy that's been pursued in the region. One can't expect one can't expect that there would be a infallible capacity to deal with so many conflicting tendencies, ambitions in a setting that was artificially created after the collapse of the Ottoman Empire at the end of World War I. And I guess that the guiding criterion that I would put before you, in a way, is what Florence Nightingale said about dealing with the sick and wounded, and that is, first of all, do no harm. You know, that's something that I think our policymakers in Washington should put above their desks and maybe above their beds and in their bathrooms, everywhere they inhabit. Because I do think that the way in which the United States has used its power in the region has contributed to the intensification of the violence and of the chaos and of the suffering. And there is this sense now that what has happened in the especially in the period since the 9/11 attacks in the United States has been worse than a disappointment. It's really viewed as a kind of failure, and even such a staunch advocate of the policies pursued as the former Prime Minister of Britain, Tony Blair, acknowledged as much in a talk given a couple weeks ago, in which he said, and I'm quoting him, "We have tried intervention and putting down troops in Iraq. We've tried intervention without putting in troops in Libya. And we've tried no intervention at all, but demanding regime change in Syria. It is not clear to me that even if our policy did not work, subsequent policies would have worked better." In other words, this is an interesting formulation, because it assumes that the only option of policy is military intervention by the West in this region. And either you do it or you don't do it, and he's disappointed because whether you do it or you don't do it, the failure is the experience. And in a sense, it embodies what I, one of the main things I think is wrong about the approach, the Western approach, and particularly the American-led approach to the region, and that is its excessive militarization. And the alternative to militarization is to respect the outcome of the dynamics of self-determination, whether you like that outcome at the moment or not. In other words, there's no way of getting the political outcome you wish for. And so the question is, what is the second best? And I'm trying to argue that non-intervention and respect for international law and the authority of the United Nations is better than trying to control the political outcome by military intervention, which has a horrible record of failure ever since the Vietnam War. Interestingly, it didn't fail before World War II. The colonial period showed that it was very efficient to rely on military superiority to achieve political outcomes that were desirable. But after World War II, in this period of the collapse of colonialism, the most important unlearned lesson is that military superiority cannot determine political outcomes. And that was the failure of the American experience in Vietnam, in which there was extraordinary military superiority in land, air, and sea. And there was a long commitment, and yet in the end, the political outcome was a complete defeat for the goals that were being pursued by the United States. Now, there was a conversation between an American colonel, a counterinsurgency expert, and his Vietnamese counterpart at the end of the Vietnam War, in which they were sort of discussing the experience. And the American said to the Vietnamese, "You know, you never defeated us on the battlefield." And his Vietnamese counterpart said, "You're right, but it's irrelevant." See, and learning that irrelevance and why it's irrelevant is a crucial somehow blockage in the political there's a disability in Washington that prevents it from learning this lesson. We keep reinventing counterinsurgency warfare. Among my students over the years was General David Petraeus, and he rose to the height of the military by saying, "We lost in Vietnam, but there's a better way to do this." And he wrote a new manual for counterinsurgency warfare. And so there are two reasons why we can't learn this lesson, in my view. The first is that the governmental bureaucracy is so militarized since the end of World War II that it can't absorb, it can't exert its political imagination be outside the military box. And so whenever a challenge comes, whenever a horrible event occurs, the reflex, the political reflex is to strike back militarily. Even in situations where you know that it may actually aggravate the problem rather than overcome it. This The French president, after these Paris attacks, adopted the George W. Bush response to the ISIS attacks, saying this was an act of war and we have to exterminate ISIS. We would have had a different world, in my view, after 9/11, if we had done what European governments have done for decades and what had been done all over the world previous to 9/11, and that is treat the attacks as a crime, not a war. War is between sovereign states. As soon as you extend the notion of war to deal with non-state actors, you're on very treacherous ground that doesn't really produce the results you wish. And for every, it's not clear, as you know, of all people, Donald Rumsfeld acknowledged, we have no metric to, he used some language like that, we have no metric to decide whether when we attack, we're killing more militants or generating more recruits. You know, there's the double effect that exists in relation to this kind of militarized mode of foreign policy. So the first kind of mistake, in my view, is this obsessive reliance on military power, because we've invested so much in it for so long that we don't know how to do anything else well. And the second mistake is we don't appreciate how in this period since the end of World War II, the balance of forces in the conflicts in the southern part of the world has changed in such a way as to explain why winning on the battlefield is not equivalent to controlling the political outcome. And what that really translates into is that there's been a confidence that has confidence has been created in countries that were initially under colonial rule, that if they persisted in challenging the colonial power, even with military inferiority, they would succeed. See, that no longer was history, the agency of history, determined by military superiority. And probably the best, clearest example of that was India's gaining independence from the British Empire by means of nonviolent resistance. India, the jewel of the British Empire, was not possible to maintain that kind of control against a mobilized resistance. And whether that resistance was nonviolent, as in the case of Gandhi's movement, or it was violent, as in the case with the Ho Chi Minh resistance movement in Vietnam, they come to the same end, because the cause of nationalism is an absolute for the people engaged in it, whereas the cause of intervention and colonial rule is relative to its benefits and losses. So the intervener loses patience. It's not worth it. Vietnam at the end was not worth it, didn't seem to be worth the effort. It was better to get out than to stay in. And that happened to the colonial power. It happened to France and Algeria eventually. And in all these cases, if you look at the record of the colonial struggles, they all were ended by the efforts of the mobilized population. And a mobilized population that also took advantage of a anti-colonial world public opinion and United Nations. The United Nations started off as being sympathetic with colonial rule, but by the 60s, 1960s, it was supportive of the struggles of peoples for their own national independence. So there was a legitimacy, what I call legitimacy war, won by the non-Western peoples struggling against colonial rule. And by a legitimacy war, I mean that they were able to shift international law and international morality and public opinion to their side. And again, as I've tried to indicate, the side that wins the legitimacy war usually wins the struggle for whatever goals it has. It doesn't always win. For instance, if Tibet has won the legitimacy war and yet can't gain political independence from China, or Chechnya in relation to what was the Soviet Union or now Russia. So there's no guarantee, but the trend of history is strongly on the side, the resistance side, and the balance of forces have definitely shifted in favor of national self-determination. So national self-determination, that is allowing the forces that operate within a country to prevail, is something that is altering in a fundamental way history. It's altering it in a way that we have yet to acknowledge and adjust to, because, as I say, we've so heavily invested in thinking that the military might of the country can control the history as it unfolds. And part of the distinctiveness or originality of the situation in the Middle East is that the two most antagonistic forces, in a way, are ISIS on the one side and the United States on the other side. And if you examine closely that reality, it becomes clear that neither one is a state in the conventional sense. ISIS is obviously not a state, but although it claims to be a caliphate and occupies territory in Syria and Iraq. The United States is not a state in the conventional sense because it has upwards of 1,000 foreign military bases, it has navies in every ocean, it has militarized space, and it, in other words, it's a global state. It's not an empire, but it's a global state. It can act and claims the interest in acting anywhere, anywhere in the world where its interests are at stake. And this, it's developed this technology that facilitates a securitization of the world, so to speak. And drone technology is expressive of that new way of ignoring boundaries, ignoring the conventional notion of conflict being between territorial states. So we haven't yet been able to absorb what this new situation entails. What does it mean to have non-states in this kind of antagonistic relationship, when international law was evolved to deal exclusively with the interaction of sovereign states. And the United Nations is based on the idea that only states and only states can be members, that no other political actors have a status that entitles them to participate in the formation of global policy, particularly in the area of war and peace. And so that tension, it's a kind of world order tension between the way in which the authority is distributed and the way in which conflict is now being enacted in most dramatically in the Middle East. There is a, in contrast to the kind of view that Tony Blair gave that really looked at success and failure in terms of whether Western intervention was succeeding or not, is a point of view that was well expressed by a peace activist, Tom Mayer, in Boulder, Colorado, who has a quite good listserv called Just Peace in the Middle East. And he writes, and I quote, "U.S. military intervention has been a calamity in the Middle East. They have destroyed Iraq, destabilized Libya, fostered dictatorship in Egypt, accelerated civil war in Syria and the destruction of Yemen, and helped squelch a pro-democracy movement in Bahrain." Now, it's important to note the difference between what Mayer is saying and what Blair was saying. Because what Mayer takes as the criterion of success and failure is not controlling the outcome, which is what intervention seeks to do, but rather what's the effect on the people who are the theater of intervention, where the intervention takes place? Have they endured suffering and terrible consequences as a result of these policies? So you look not at at foreign policy from the perspective of the government that is trying to control, but you look at it from the perspective of the people that are being controlled. And that gives you a very different set of criteria by which to judge success and failure. And my own experience in Vietnam was very much that along that line. I was very affected by the by visiting Vietnam during the course of the war and seeing the war from the perspective of the victims, even though earlier I had opposed the war on a kind of realist, from a realist perspective, as something that was not likely to succeed given the fact that the French had already failed in trying to do the same thing. So in other words, I was looking at it in this Blairist way of success or failure of intervention. But when I went there, and I went there a couple of times and had the experience of meeting the leaders in North Vietnam and bringing back three American pilots at one point that were released to so-called representatives of the American peace movement, it was transformative for me to see this peasant society, this beautiful country that had no way of defending itself, no way of hitting back. See, and one of the things that we should be learning in the Middle East and which our adversaries have learned is that you, if you want to really defeat interventionary diplomacy, you have to hit back. See, in Paris, and the downing of the Russian plane, and in a certain sense, 9/11 itself, were all ways of saying, you may think you're controlling oil in the Middle East, or you may think you're imposing secularism or democracy, and that you can do that without suffering consequences. What these groups are expressing is, however barbaric our tactics, we have a way of inflicting pain. War traditionally is a kind of reciprocity. There is a connection between an interaction between the two sides. When we fought the 1991 Gulf War, we began talking about zero casualty wars. Our leaders talked about zero casualty wars and that we had gotten over finally what they called the Vietnam syndrome. But this is really a deferred answer to the illusion of zero casualty wars. And that again is something that one needs to understand. It's not clear what you do about it, but you need to understand that that is a very important part of the kind of dynamic that occurs in these situations where military intervention produces what they started to call in Afghanistan blowback, where you do something. In that case, we were supporting Islamic fundamentalists in order to defeat the Russian-Soviet intervention. And among those we supported were Osama bin Laden, and trained and equipped his efforts in Afghanistan. And the blowback, of course, was the turning against the U.S. in a later phase of the development of the Al-Qaeda movement. The other aspect of what I believe to be the mistaken kind of policies that the U.S. has pursued is connected with the two sets of special relationships that the United States has had, the relationship with Israel and the relationship with Saudi Arabia. In both of these relationships, well, first of all, I should say something about special relationships means that you suspend any critical judgment and you unconditionally support the other country. George Washington, in his farewell address, gave the advice that the United States should never enter into entangling alliances, by which he meant it was best to stay out of all the mess that was being made in Europe and not get involved in European wars. And so the US, with the oceans in between, pursued for a long time this notion that one shouldn't get involved in alliances with foreign countries. But these special relationships are much deeper than alliances, because they in effect say, even if the other country does things that are harmful to national interests, we will look the other way and let those things go forward. In the case of Saudi Arabia, it's very obvious, and in a way it should be shocking, that Saudi Arabia has for decades, not just years, been financing Islamic extremism around the world, and has made no secret of the fact that its version of Islam, which is at variance with most interpretations of Islam, the so-called Wahhabism that believes that the Islamic that adhering to Islam means doing what was done in the 7th century when the religion was founded. But it involves a very rigid and fundamentalist way of reading the Quran and in implementing it. And that's the version of Islam that Saudi billions have been supporting. And because we have for so long regarded oil as more important than ideas, we have tended to look the other way and even take great pride. All our presidents of recent years have taken great pride at being photographed with the Saudi king and showing their friendship of the Saudi royal family. It's not only oil, it's also arms sales. There are other explanations for this. But it's the we criticize Iran all the time for its human rights violations with justification. But Iran is a liberal society compared to Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia has had more beheadings since January 1st than ISIS. It has public lashings of those that are accused of political and social crimes. It is truly, if you know, President Obama constantly says, well, our foreign policy has to be guided by our values. But it's a mockery of that kind of assertion to embrace the Saudi monarchy, given the way it practices, and to tolerate this support for this kind of jihadi Islam being disseminated and generating the extremism that produces the kind of attacks that occurred in Paris. So it's completely incoherent, on the one hand, to conduct a, say we're fighting a war on terror, and ignore what Saudi Arabia has been doing and is doing to facilitate terror. It's a very, that part of this special relationship really challenges one's understanding of how foreign policy is made in this country. The special relationship with Israel is, of course, more controversial because there were a lot of reasons for supporting Israel at its founding and in the aftermath of the Holocaust, and given the strength of the Zionist movement worldwide. But as time has gone by, and it's become more and more evident that Israel isn't prepared to allow a fair solution of the conflict with the Palestinian people, or to allow Palestinian self-determination to occur, it becomes very clear that one of the things that fuels the extremism in the region is this failure to deal in a just way with the Palestinian grievances. It seems almost self-evident that if this conflict had been solved 20 years ago, it's unlikely that 9/11 would have occurred, and it's unlikely that a lot of the other developments that seem so dangerous and challenging would have taken place. Of course, you don't know what would have happened. No one can read history backwards in any accurate fashion. But it is clear that the the targeting of the United States is related to a series of grievances that have been evolving in that part of the world, and that the one-sided support of Israel, the unconditional support of Israel, even when the World Court handed down a near unanimous opinion on the separation wall, the US rejected that. It rejected the Goldstone Report on the Gaza War of 2008-2009. In other words, it's whatever Israel does, the US will look the other way, or more than look the other way. It will use its diplomatic and geopolitical muscle to insulate Israel from criticism. And even when it goes against the Israeli policy, as it has in forming this agreement with Iran, it is so, which was a very commonsensical arrangement that was supported by all permanent members of the Security Council and Germany. It wasn't just an American initiative. And Israel and Saudi Arabia were the two countries that opposed that. But because Israel opposed that, we're now contemplating and probably will give Israel $5 billion of military assistance each year instead of $3 billion. In other words, we have to compensate for displeasing Israel by reaching this agreement with Iran on its nuclear program. So one sees the need for the rethinking of these special relationships. It's not going to happen. None of the political candidates that seem likely to be competing for the presidency in 2016 would even entertain this notion of questioning. Maybe they would question the Saudi support for jihadism. I don't know. But that's as far as one can imagine going. I don't want to talk too long, but I did want to say just something about the degree to which some of the problems in the region have to be understood in relation to what happened at the end of World War I. Because after the collapse of the Ottoman Empire, there were many things done, but two stand out and are part of the instability that has come to the surface in recent years. And the first of these is the Sykes-Picot Agreement that was reached in 1916. Next year will be the 100th anniversary. And interestingly, ISIS in its manifesto said, the end of Sykes-Picot. We are dedicated to end of Sykes-Picot. And what Sykes-Picot did was secretly, while World War I was still going on, British and French diplomats secretly agreed on how to divide up the Ottoman Empire between themselves. In other words, this undermined the Woodrow Wilson idea, which was a much more positive approach to the aftermath of the Ottoman Empire, which was to allow self-determination to determine the political communities that would emerge in a post-Ottoman Middle East. Instead, there was eventually a kind of compromise reached where Britain and France controlled all the countries in the region and created these boundaries that were a matter of colonial partnerships, but they put them under the nominal control of the League of Nations in the form of the mandate system. And that's where, in a sense, they promised indefinitely some kind of independence, but they administered them as if they were colonies. And these were very artificial political communities that could only be held together by strong leaders. It meant that you couldn't anticipate any kind of democratic development in these societies, which had mixed ethnic, mixed religious character, and had boundaries that were set for colonial convenience, not because they represented natural political communities. You have to remember that the European countries emerged out of a historical process in which there was a kind of self-determination. They emerged as nations with minorities and lots of problems associated with that, but they were natural, more or less natural political communities. So you had this, and this is important because it has meant that the European concept of the state, which was imposed on the Middle East, has very little legitimacy for the people in the region. They, what is legitimate for them are either the tribal loyalties, as in countries like Yemen or Libya, and to some degree in Iraq, or this renewal of the idea of a caliphate, or what Osama bin Laden called Ummah. In other words, the Islamic community is more legitimate than is the territorial sovereign state that has owes its origins to Europe. And it's very, Khomeini was the first person to really make this point very clearly, because after the revolution in Iran in 1979, he made it very clear repeatedly, this was not an Iranian revolution, it was an Islamic revolution. And what he meant by that was that the relevant political community for the people of Iran was not bounded by the borders that were set internationally. Wherever societies were Islamic, that was part of the primary political community. And so what this has meant is that legitimacy in the Middle East isn't really associated with this territorial sovereign state. And that means these other kinds of what seem to us to be crazy and radical claims have a resonance, have a legitimacy in the region. And it's important to understand that. It's not, again, it's not a matter of accepting it, but it is a recognition that you can't export legitimacy from the Western world and expect it to take root in a part of the world that has experienced such trauma over such a long period of time. The second event in the deep root of the present situation was the Balfour Declaration, which promised the Zionist movement a Jewish homeland in historic Palestine. And again, this was done in the British Foreign Office without any consultation of the people that lived in that region, and has continued to be characteristic of how Palestine has been dealt with. When the British that were administering the territory decided they could no longer handle the conflict, they gave it to the UN to deal with. The UN decreed partition, but again, without any consultation of the population subject to the plan. It was the external telling, it's very paternalistic, telling another society how it should live. And if there's one theme that I'm trying to stress tonight, it's the importance, the political, moral, and historical primacy of self-determination. And everything else that is tried results in a combination of blowback and disappointment. And that simple kind of understanding would at least correspond or at least acknowledge Florence Nightingale's wisdom of doing no harm. Because, as I said at the outset, failure is probably unavoidable in the region, but we could do less harm. And how we get a political leadership that is prepared to do less harm is, I think, the challenge that faces all of us. And to be responsible citizens, it seems to me we have an obligation to try to find political representatives that are at least responsive to this rethinking of how the United States behaves in the world, behaves in the Middle East, and understands these radical challenges to the modern liberal way of understanding history and world politics. Let me stop there and hope for your questions. Thank you very much. Good. Okay.
You all right?
Yeah, fine.
Okay, can you get to the mic?
Yeah, sure.
All right, I'll just facilitate a little bit. Is anybody questions for Professor Fogg? Yes.
Should I just speak up?
Yes, please.
Okay, thank you very much for that talk. It was very insightful.
Maybe you could stand up so people can hear you a little better.
I just wanted to thank you very much for that very insightful talk. I'm a German international student. This is my third month at SIU, and I appreciate it very much.
Thank you.
So as you might be aware, there is currently a refugee situation in Europe, right, coming from a large influx from Syria, but also surrounding countries and also other parts of Europe, right? The United States, is my impression, has invaded these countries with no sense for consequence or the civilians that inhabit these areas. But now they refuse really to take responsibility for these lives that have been destroyed, and really lives that are endangered currently by the terrorism that reigns in these countries. There are states in the United States that openly admit that they don't want to accept any refugees, and I wonder what your position is on this, because Germany, for example, has been accepting over the course of 3 years more than 950,000 people. And it's becoming a huge problem, especially in light of the Paris attacks, because the animosity towards Muslim people becomes kind of aggressive in a way.
Yeah.
And the United States won't take any responsibility for this at all. And I wonder what your position is on this.
Thank you for the question. It's a very important issue, and it's there are no easy answers for it. It poses the tension between the idea of sovereignty and the idea of moral responsibility. In the way in which the world is organized, in this area, sovereignty prevails. So what countries decide to do or not to do is not subject to review. It's within their national right to. So it becomes essentially, and you put it well, I think, it becomes a moral choice and a political question. Does the United States, given its interventionary diplomacy that has generated many of these refugees, does it want to acknowledge a responsibility for the spillover from the countries where it's been involved? And there are costs of both acknowledging it and not acknowledging it. Probable effect that it would contribute to a rising xenophobia and Islamophobia. And it would likely produce a move to the right in the political society if that was done. On the other hand, if it isn't done, it creates this image of the U.S. as a very insensitive geopolitical dominant force in the world that kills people and destroys societies, but then walks away. Do we as Americans want that image? Or putting it another way, are we willing to pay the price of not having that image? Because there is, as I say, there is a real price, admitting a large number of Syrian refugees would definitely be used as a political instrument to frighten the society. And if anything went wrong, it would really push the country toward the right. So it's very hard. It's a real dilemma, I think, a genuine dilemma as to how to respond. And of course, it has economic dimensions too. The allegations that it takes away jobs and in a situation where there's a struggle already in the society for adequate employment. So there are many aspects to it.
In Syria, it seems to be the civil war is developing into a two-sided war with Bashar al-Assad, Russia, and Iran on one side, and ISIS with their backers on the other side. How do we do no harm in that situation? Do we walk away?
Well, of course.
Try to tip the balance.
There's a little story about a guy getting lost in Scotland because. In the Scottish countryside where the roads have very high hedges and there are no road signs, and he stops a local person and says, how do I get to Glasgow from here? And the local person responds in saying, if I were you, I wouldn't be starting from here. There have been many mistakes by many on many sides, and the situation was extremely confused all along, and I think it remains confused. I don't think it can be clearly reduced to a two-person struggle. There is a pro-Assad and anti-Assad, but there are also many factions in the anti-Assad side, and quite a bit of divergency in the pro-Assad side. I still think diplomacy is the best hope, and one of the obstacles to diplomacy have been these special relationships that I referred to in my remarks, because Iran has been kept out of the diplomatic process in order to please Saudi Arabia and Israel. And that you can't resolve this conflict without having Iran and probably Russia participate. Now, Russia has inserted itself now into the conflict in a way that nobody would suggest that they can be ignored. But I think it's important to bring Iran into the process and to make a some kind of accommodation that at least produces a ceasefire. Whether that ceasefire would hold or not is, of course, very uncertain.
Yes, I was actually curious, in relation to...
A little louder.
In relation to the question that was posed about the Syrian refugee crisis. Now, I recall you talking about the blowback in terms of our actions in the Middle East and how we excessively act paternalistic in these countries.
I can't hear, yes.
You need to be about twice that loud.
Or come closer to the front.
Bounce it off the wall.
Now, as there was talked about earlier, the crisis in terms of the Syrian refugees and how we're responding to this crisis. Now, I recall earlier you were talking about the concept of blowback, that our actions, our paternalistic actions have in these countries in the Middle East. Now, would you say that refusing these refugees and, in a sense, pushing them away fuels more of this blowback agenda that ISIS or the Islamic State promotes with their terror acts?
Yes, definitely. I mean, the what I didn't say in response to the earlier question was that part of the importance of this migration issue is to convey the understanding that what's done in the Middle East cannot be confined to the Middle East. And that it, and this has, I think, created new incentives to find a diplomatic solution. The Europeans don't want this kind of pressure exerted upon themselves. So that it is very instructive to understand that even though the world is divided into these territorial states, once you intervene in a very strong way in any one of them, it's going to, the consequence is going to radiate very broadly. And blowback is a good shorthand for that kind of unanticipated, hostile, and costly effects of a intervention in X country will affect A, B, C, D, and others.
How do we deal with a non-state actor who is influencing or having an impact across many states almost simultaneously? Well, we're trying to develop a diplomatic solution to the situation in Syria. It seems to me we have a number of conflicting forces at work, and ISIS being a non-state actor really draws that into focus. And there's a number of instances where we have ISIS-type actors across the world at the present time, and we really don't seem to have a very effective way of dealing with those.
No, I think that you very well articulate one of the critical challenges to a rational and coherent foreign policy. There is no good answer to how you address this problem. You do have to think about root causes. You know, what gave rise to this kind of movement, this kind of potency, and you have to learn from the fact that you can't think in short-term, short time cycles. As I tried to indicate, the way we resisted Soviet intervention in Afghanistan gave a huge surge of support to Islamic fundamentalism, because that was the effective way to resist Soviet intervention. Similarly, in Iraq, in order to create a post-Saddam Hussein Iraq, we created conditions that gave rise to ISIS. It's too. I mean, that's under the bridge, so to speak. But at least one should learn not to play those games in this world. I mean, it was one thing in the Soviet when the Soviet Union was the adversary, and it was a two-person game in effect, geopolitics. But now, with the complexity of political actors and the nature of political conflict, it is a very self-destructive way of pursuing interests and promoting a better world. So it's crucial that you try to break those habits that lead to the formation of these political actors that turn against what you are trying to achieve in the world. Now, having said that, it doesn't answer what you should do now. And I'm not sure what you should do now. I don't think there are any answers. I think random air attacks. U.S. claims to have had 8,000 air strikes against ISIS without any discernible effect. Seems unimaginable to me, but one has to learn a better way of containing this kind of political movement than what presently is being done.
Is it possible to defeat an ideology that is so deeply ingrained within a religion or within that area through military or diplomatic means? Because I don't see it ever really coming to fruition. I believe that the ideology is so deeply ingrained within these people that they'll just have the opportunity to further pass it along, and whatever diplomatic progress or military progress we might make in the defeat of extremism or ISIS in general will be circumvented by the spread of the ideology itself.
And by the ideology, you mean ISIS, or what do you mean?
ISIS brand of Islam.
The first thing to say is that this ideology or interpretation of Islam is a very, very much of a minority view. I mean, it isn't a view that is held by the great majority of Muslims in the world. It's a fringe ideology that has been, as I said, unduly empowered by the way Saudi Arabia has encouraged its emergence. But I think there is a widespread recognition, including within the Islamic world, that this is very damaging to Islamic countries. And there, again, I would be more trusting of the dynamics of self-determination to address this issue from within. What I don't think works and probably shouldn't work is intervention from without. See, and without the intervention from without, it's unlikely that other countries, other societies will be targeted. These are responses, however pathological, to the feeling of grievance and prior intervention.
Regarding your argument about respecting self-determination in the region, Who is the self that you're referring to? Because it seems to me there are multiple selves there. Is the self whose wishes and desires we should respect the government leaders in these mostly autocratic states? Is it the majority will of the populations of those states? Is it minority ethnic groups within these states, such as Kurds and Copts? Whose will should we respect and not interfere in?
Well, that's of course a very important question, and the conceptualization of self-determination has bothered scholars and others for a long time. I think the only practical answer is to respect the political outcome of conflict and to minimize external intervention. And as I've said, that doesn't mean you'll like what happens in each particular case. But I think it will be less destructive and less less of a failure of American policy to try to decide who should be governing in a particular country that we have a strong interest in. And notice that we don't intervene in countries where there isn't a strong material interest. There was intervention in Libya, as Blair pointed out in that quote I read. There's intervention where there's oil. There's non-intervention of a sort, or very low-level intervention, where there's no oil. If you look at the Middle East, Libya and Iraq were the two countries, and Iran being threatened. They're three major oil producers. Syria, Yemen, Egypt are not oil producers. So that we have to separate this oil geopolitics from our understanding of what a rational foreign policy toward the Middle East is at this stage. And I agree that self-determination is a slippery concept. And the self, I mean, from an international law point of view, it's supposed to be associated with the people. Both human rights covenants in their first article proclaim the right of self-determination as adhering in the peoples, not the states or even the societies or the nations, but in the peoples. And what is a people? See, that's another deep ambiguity. But thank you for the question. It was important.
Stand up and project like mad because it has to go back there.
Okay. So things seem to be going relatively well in Tunisia. Why is that? Or is that true?
good question. And it's good. The formulation was particularly good because you said relatively well. There are problems, but compared to Egypt or to Syria or Yemen, they're going spectacularly well. Because in those places, it's going so badly. There are several things that seem to me to have had an effect in Tunisia. One is that the Islamic movement there, which was very strong, was also very pluralistic. Unlike in the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt, it recognized the importance of incorporating the non-Islamic parts of the society and sharing political power. Second thing was that they had a strong independent labor movement that was able to create a kind of active and fairly stable civil society. And the third thing is that the leadership that had been part of the former autocracy quickly shifted sides and became overnight a liberal kind of democratizing leadership. And the current leader, as you probably know, is somebody that was prominent in the oldest Tunisian establishment that was dictatorial, but now he takes a softer line. And so Tunisia has made a certain kind of transition. The dark sides of it is that they do have a terrorist problem domestically, the incidents in the museum and on the beach. They don't have as much change as the original revolutionary uprising was hoping for. You still have the same elites in power. You still have the same economic structure. So you can ask the question, how much was really achieved by what happened in Tunisia?
Very short, we might squeeze in two.
Thank you for your talk, Mr. Prabhak. I think this talk should be given to the Congress and our current leaders who are especially running for election, because I don't see inside if they have learned anything the way they are talking about the bombing the blank out of the ISIS and everything. And the number two question, do you think there is any blame to go to invading Iraq, especially because at that time I think Saddam Hussein called it mother of all wars, and like it's going to give birth to many wars, and that's what is happening currently.
Yes, thank you very much for that comment and question. Not wanting to speak so long, I was going to emphasize the Iraq intervention as a very important mistake in the region, and a recent mistake that has created a lot of the problems, including contributing to the formation of ISIS. Also, shifted the country from an autocracy to a chaotic civil strife situation, causing close to a million casualties, several million people displaced. It's hard to imagine Iraq as badly off under Saddam Hussein as it is after this intervention. And I think that the policy planners in the Pentagon would welcome the second coming of Saddam Hussein at this point, because order is more valued than chaos, even if it's a imposed order. I had said earlier that there's a saying in the region that people prefer 100 years of tyranny to 1 year of chaos. And I think what we've generated in the region through this Iraqi intervention and then the aftermath of the Arab uprisings in 2011 is a situation of pervasive chaos.
We're going a little bit over. There has been a question from the back. I think it's Bastien back there has had his hand up. No, also.
Yes.
It was Bastien who had his hand up first. So you can turn it off later on. And we'll have a few minutes with Dr. Falk outside as well, so you can buttonhole him outside. Yeah.
ISIS is founding itself.
A little louder?
Much louder.
ISIS is founding itself using oil and banks in Syria and Iraqi territories. And no Western countries have done anything to stop this financing. I'd like to know your opinion on that, especially on the banks use international canals to transfer money, and there has been no economic blockade, let's say, of this means of finance?
I don't really know enough to say what could be done to prevent this. There's the claim that the U.S. is now bombing the oil fields so that they can't make use of the oil. I don't know what you do about the they took over the currency in Mosul, the banks, and gained a lot of currency. It's very difficult to control the activities of these non-state actors if they're well organized and have any kind of positive connections with foreign governments that have an interest in either causing chaos or helping them. And I just don't know enough to know what might be more effective.
I'm afraid we're going to have to, I'm sorry? I'm sorry, who?
Do you have time for one more?
Well, no, but if you want to stay over, we do. I mean, how do you feel? Vote yes?
Yeah.
Yes, yeah. The eyes have it. Yes, please.
I'll make it quick. I just had a question about, in finding a diplomatic solution to the crisis in Syria, how critical do you think the partnership between the U.S. and Russia is? And if you do, is it possible, given how complicated that relationship is, based on previous events and recent stuff like Russia's invasion in Ukraine?
Yeah, unfortunately, it is possible. The relations between governments can be very fickle, very cynical, and if it is perceived to be in the strong interest of both Moscow and Washington to find common ground, they will find it. You know, countries overnight change their views about terrorist organizations. You remember the British changed their view of the IRA overnight when they decided they could find a diplomatic accommodation. Israel did the same thing with the PLO back in the early 1990s. When there's a political will, the seeming public tensions disappear very rapidly. And when there's no political will, nothing is possible.
We're going to have to let Professor Falk off the hot seat now. But thank you all for being here. I think there is.